hear me. I sort of have a voice that projects anyway. So I love Google Images. I found this here today for wake up. You know, when you're the last talk of the day, it's a good thing. It's pictures and rashes. That can be a little bit more entertaining. It keeps us awake a little bit more than other things. But I don't know about you guys, but I could not live without my caffeine. So I'm going to talk about childhood phantoms, and I have spoken at this meeting before, usually about, you know, people want to hear about rashes a lot. So I've spoken on different rash topics, and I do, I'm not a dermatologist, I am a general pediatrician, but I have an interest in newborn nursery, breastfeeding, our hospital, just become baby friendly, UK. If you guys haven't heard, it's huge, huge thing. So I'm a nursery director. That's been my goal of a lifetime, really. And then also I'm very interested in dermatology. So I have worked in the past with Dr. Fisher. And I don't know how many of you guys remember. Anybody remember Dr. Fisher? So his Joan Fisher, and he was a fabulous pediatrician. And it's interesting that he had the same, you know, two interests that I have, or I have the same two interests he had, which is newborn care and skin or dermatologic disorders. And some of my peers call me Donetta because I'm taken after him. But anyway, I wanted to just dedicate this talk to him because he was such a valuable pediatrician and a mentor and a friend. And I don't know that I really ever told him that enough when he was alive. And the other reason I'm dedicating this to him is that when I heard that you guys wanted to hear about measles, I had to go to some of his old slides that he had given me. Because, you know, I've been in pediatrician, so if I count residency starting in 1986, the only case I've ever seen of measles was when I was scuba diving with my husband in Fiji, and we were at this church service, it was Easter, and this little kid turned around and had this horrible conjunctivitis and rash and looked sick as crap. And I remember thinking, daggone, that kid looks sick. And one of our other people on the dive trip was pregnant. Well, she gets back to the United States, and 2 weeks later after our trip, she comes down with a rash, goes to the ID doctors, and she's diagnosed with measles. And I'm like, oh, now I know what that kid is. So that's the only measles that I've ever seen, but Dr. Fisher had seen much more. And so some of these slides are from his collection. And I can remember being a medical student going through, and this was before computers, and he would have these carousels, and they would have like this, you know, they would have the slide carousels and the pictures, and then he would have just this paper kind of outline that we would go with it. And you have to go through all the carousels in pediatrics. And, you know, I don't think I appreciated how important that was, but I was thankful for him to know that. To share, and he would love to see us talking about this today. So a sort of objective is just a review common and not so common. I'm going to tell you measles in the not so common category. Evaluate different ways to differentiate it, learn the course and prognosis of these different conditions. Then sometimes I do cases and I do the turning point as I go through the talk, but I decided that this time I was just going to do the questions at the end. So that's another challenge to stay awake. So we'll test a little bit. We'll do some case presentations at the very end. And I'm not going to overwhelm you with, you know, 1,500 different kinds of rashes. So the one thing about just skin disorders in general or rashes in general is that they intimidate everybody. And when I give this, I give a general talk to the medical students and I give about 7 or 8 talks a year to the residents, and they're always like, oh my gosh, rashes are so scary to me. And I don't know what they are, and they're overwhelming. And so it's something that sort of the more you see, then the better you get. But it's something that you have to do a lot of. So, and the thing is that a lot of rashes are not just the rash themselves, but they usually go along with something else. So they can be a clue to a neurocutaneous disorder. They can be a clue to a very serious bacterial infection that requires immediate ICU, ER and ICU stay. Or it can just be hardly anything at all. But sometimes it's really hard to know. And the fact that it's a clinical diagnosis makes it a little bit more challenging to us because there's not really You know, you're not going to do a skin biopsy of a kid in your clinic and try to figure out what the rash is. So it's a challenge. And when we talk about rashes in general, there's two sort of terms. So exanthem just means that it's a skin, you know, it's Greek for breaking out. So it's just a skin eruption on the skin. And then the enanthem is mucous membranes. And so mucous membranes, we usually think of oral mucosa. But remember, if you have a kid that has Steven Johnson's, for example, you have to look at the tympanic membrane, to look at the genitalia, because there are other mucosal surfaces on the body other than mouth and eyes, which are the ones that are sort of most obvious to us. And, you know, just remember that many infectious diseases are accompanied by a rash. And if we know the characteristics of a particular rash with an infectious etiology, can help us a lot. And I tell the medical students, there's certain terms that people who write board questions love to say, you know, rose, dewdrop on a rose petal, I mean, sort of things that old people just like to keep on throwing out. And now you could be one of those older people, but so sometimes just knowing the characteristics can be helpful even without seeing the rash. And so that's helpful to pay attention to. And then just sort of general important observations. So when you see a rash, it can be kind of overwhelmed. So you see that parent freak out factor. Sometimes it's the doctor or the nurse freak out factor, like, wow, oh yeah, that's bad. I'm not sure what it is, but it's kind of scary. So if you kind of look at sort of the morphology, so what the individual lesions, what we call the primary lesion of the rash, can be very helpful in the diagnosis. The distribution, so where it is on the body and how it's distributed, and then where did it start and where did it go? So all that they're all a lot of course, we always say everything in medicine, it always goes back to the history and physical most of the time. And that's still true, even though, you know, with our technology, we sometimes do more tests. But with rashes, there's not going to be a whole lot of tests you're going to have to do, so you have to go back to the old stuff. Prodromal, so were they sick before the rash came on, or did the rash come on at the same time of them feeling ill? Concurrent symptoms, what else is going on with them? Known exposures, did they travel somewhere? What's going on in the community, what's going on in the school? So all of those things are really important for helping me figure out what's going on with the rash. So if we look back, and if we're talking about measles, we're going back sort of to the history of rashes. And this was a numerical classification used in the early 1900s. Now, is this helpful these days to know this? You know, probably not to know what number goes with what, I mean, unless you're taking the board test. And some of them are known as, you know, fist disease or six disease, so some people might use that terminology. But this was just a way that they used to classify way back when, before they really had any way to diagnose the infectious etiology. So it was by numbers, 1 through 6. And the first one on there is measles. And I'm not going to go through and read all of this. You guys have it in your handout. It goes all the way through 6. 4 is one that really has kind of been thrown out. So we don't pay too much attention to that one. So let's just talk about measles, first of all. So when we talk about the pre-vaccine era, so before 1963 in the United States, every child developed measles. So there were 10,000 new cases a day. And so that was just very commonplace. Everybody knew what it was. There were complications back then. And it was a big deal when the live vaccine was introduced. And it worked very well. So measles vaccine, unlike some of our other vaccines, for example, pertussis, you get a pertussis 5 years after your pertussis, even 2 years after your pertussis, your immunity wanes. You know, our kids that were boosted at age 11, 12 now, by the time they go to college, they're susceptible again to pertussis. So some of the vaccines don't work very well. Measles vaccine works very well. And actually the booster that we now give, that we started in 1990, is not really to boost it, but really is to try to immunize the individuals that didn't get immunized the first time, that didn't have a good immune response. So it works very, very well. So in 2000, the US declared that measles was eliminated. That doesn't mean there were zero cases. It means that it was under a certain number. So they could really say, we've really eliminated measles. That is a pretty cool thing. Then down to 37 people in 2004. Then you can see 668 people within the United States in 2014. Hey, what happened? We still got the vaccine, right? Why are we seeing this? Majority of people who are getting it are unvaccinated. What has happened? You guys have seen it some. There's a whole, you know, group of people who don't want to immunize their children. And that is getting us into trouble. One of the other things is that people are traveling a lot more. And so there are a lot of people that are coming into the country who are not vaccinated. But what happens is one person who hasn't been vaccinated, you know, comes in with it. They are in a community where there's a lot of kids that are not vaccinated, and there you have an epidemic in the United States. And so, you know, there's lots of movements. At the end of the handout, there's a site that I've listed that talks about talking to families about immunizations. There's lots of really good stuff on the CDC. If you guys don't have a folder in your individual office or where you're working, to be able to give those to parents to read about and say, hey, okay, I respect your opinion, whatever, but here, why don't you read this for next time? Then I think that could be very helpful. And it's still very common in many parts of the world. So Fiji, for example, is my example. But Europe, Asia, the Pacific, and Africa, so it is still out there. And of course, we have travelers, so we can say that. Okay, this map was of May 2015, very recent, right? So where's Kentucky? We are in zero cases. So, okay, you don't probably have to worry about measles today or tomorrow or the next 6 months unless something changes. You can see that California was the number one here, and that was probably because of that epidemic with Disneyland. So when it's being seen, it's in certain sort of areas where there are specific cases that are spreading. So let's just talk about it a little bit though, just so you know what not to miss, even though I'm going to tell you it's going to be, should be low on your list. So incubation period is about the same as varicella, about 2 weeks. So then if you see somebody and you think they got measles, who were they around about 2 weeks ago? Where were they? What is their travel history? And then sort of how the kid presents. And so this is really helpful because the rash doesn't come when they first get sick. So if you just know that part about different infections and rashes, you can rule a lot of stuff out just by the history. So they're going to get fever, and then it becomes actually quite significant. So certain infections have higher fever typically than others. This is one that the kids get really high tests, 103, 104. And then the three C's, conjunctivitis, cough, coryza, and then there's the K, which is coughlet. So some people say three C's and a K. So that's important. There's not a lot of other really viral infections that have a rash that have conjunctivitis with it. That is sort of an unusual manifestation of an otherwise viral example. Temperature's high. The kids are sick looking. So if they come in and they've got a rash and they're smiling, they do not have measles. The rash appears 2 to 4 days after the prodrome, and then the progression. So most viral exanthems, you know, we call something a viral, you know, viral exanthem. They had a little runny nose, and now they've got a rash. Most of the time, it's a truncal rash. And it starts on the trunk and then can spread some to the face and extremities. But measles is different. It starts at the face and goes down. And the way that the way that it starts is also another clue as to what it is. Erythematous red macules. So macules are flat areas, and then there also can be raised areas, which are papules. They can become confluent, and then they will fade in the order that they came. And then you can also get desquamation or sort of peeling at the end. So you get the three C's, then you get the coughlet spots. I personally have not seen coughlet spots, but this is a picture from Dr. Fisher's collection. And it looks, what I've been told of people, I was asking Dr. Badgett, who does a lot of derm for us, he said it kind of looks like, almost like they've got, you know, candida in their mouth. So it's not, you know, it's not even as shiny, it's this tiny little white spots that are very, very easy to miss. Certainly the parent's not going to tell you that. And really, that's one of the things as pediatricians, when we see a kid with a rash, we need to make sure to do a good oral exam. Not always easy on a toddler, really, but it's an important part of the exam to do. They are pathognomonic of measles, and so if you see that, then it's really important to know. But it's not there very long, and you're going to have to look in the mouth to see it. So this kid does not look He looks sick, you can tell he's got kind of conjunctivitis, his rash. More concentrated really on the face, it has spread down to the trunk and the extremities. And the macules or the reddened areas are larger than what we see with typical, what I would say, other myelexanthemas. Roseola would be an example of that, usually those are smaller. And then on day two of the rash, it appears blotchy, and day three, it can become confluent. So this is a really old, and some of the old stuff is the best. Mm-hmm. You know, clinicians don't have time anymore to, the good clinicians who are seeing patients day in and day out, that the administrators are pushing them to see patients all the time. So the old days of, you know, general pediatricians writing an article or writing something with a lot of really good practical knowledge, it's not there much anymore. So some of the old stuff is really the best. And sometimes people make fun of when I get out these articles that are like yellow, you know, I just hand them out in the nursery, and I'll say, okay guys, don't look at the date and discount it just because it's 15 years old. So this is a really, really helpful, and because it's sort of visualized, as I'm like a visual learner, that this is the first day of the rash, okay? So first they get the fever, they're sick, they get the conjunctivitis, cough, and then when the rash appears, which is about the third day or so of the illness, then you're gonna get the pop-up spots. The rash is gonna start on the face, be a little bit starting down this way, and then as it progresses, it's gonna be much more impressive, and gonna spread all the way down. Pop-up spots are gone, so they're a very transient phenomena. This little girl is, again, you can tell just by looking at their face how sick kids look, right? You can tell when you walk in the door. So this kid is just miserable. This was a Dr. Fisher picture. So it's called the measly facies, you know, so they just look bad. The conjunctivitis, it's important to kind of note what kind of conjunctivitis it is because there are different kinds of conjunctivitis that we see. They're not all the same. So, for example, with this, it's a very, they have a lot of clear discharge from their eyes. The sclera are injected, but it's not usually a pussy discharge. Versus, I'm just trying to think, like if you had a drug reaction, you can get a severe conjunctivitis, Stephen Johnson's, but they have more involvement of the lids, and they also, it's more of an exudative with a purulent drainage. So the type of conjunctivitis is also helpful. Congestion of the buccal cavity, and then dusky red blotchy rashes. And then as the rash clears, then you get this kind of brawny desquamation, which is very superficial. And of course, by then, you know, the kid's already contaminated a bunch of people if you didn't know what it is. So that's one of those things. And it's not that helpful after the fact, right? But it is something to tell the parents about. And it is different than we do also see post healing with scarlet fever, but that is more kind of like thin sheets of skin and not this kind of blind desquamation. So what about one of the sort of scary things about measles is, and when there is an epidemic, the reason why it spreads so much is it is airborne, and not that many infections can you just be in the same room and not touch the patient or not touch the person or not drink after the person and get sick, and this is one of them. Varicella, the same thing, is airborne, and very few infections that we have in pediatrics are airborne, and so that's why it's so contagious. So, and really kind of scary, so if you have a patient, you go in there, you thought they had measles, you clean the whole room, you disinfect it, it's still in the air for 2 hours. So really, you almost have to block the room off for 2 hours. And so this would be something that if the kid was in the hospital, they would have some type of be in a room with like that reverse airflow or something, you know, so the air isn't circulating outside of that room. If you have somebody that you think has measles, how do you make the diagnosis? And this has happened in Twilight Clinic, and actually I called one of the ID docs at UK just to make sure that they really hadn't had any true cases. And if you want to really see what we're doing now for a lot of infections are PCRs. They're much more reliable than serology or cultures for different diseases. And so they're really kind of taking over. So if you really wanted to know, then you would get a PCR pharyngeal swab, which is going to be a special swab. You're going to have to, you know, call your hospital lab probably and ask about it. And that gets sent to the state. And that's how, if you really want to know, if that's what you're saying or not, but I wouldn't do that on most kids unless you were really sure, because it's a very expensive test. So a recent Disney outbreak is a disease where the complication rate is high, 20% required hospitalization. The younger the kids, the sicker they get. And complications, pneumonia, encephalitis, otitis media is very high, but that's not one of the ones that we really don't know about. Now, this is another kind of old slide that I really just love, and I'm going to have to somehow put this in one of my resident talks because I think it's just so helpful. So it just sort of compares different rashes that we're going to see in kids. Again, these two are going to be the least common that we're going to see. We still see a lot of these too, and we'll talk about those. But if you look here, what I love about this is, again, it's just the visualization of when things occur. So if you have a kid that comes in, and they've got a temp of 102 or 103, mom said they got sick today, and they have a rash, it's not measles. So remember, these kids, they start out with a fever, and then it peaks at about the fourth or fifth day, up to 104, and the rash starts right about here. So they've been sick for a couple of days with conjunctivitis, coryza, cough, and fever before the rash happens. And these cockle spots are going to happen somewhere in between and go away very quickly. And we'll talk about the other ones as we go. But just to kind of visualize, the sequence of events is very, very important. Not just sort of seeing walking into a room and seeing a morbilliform rash, which is what we described the measles rash is. That is sort of the measles morbilliform. I don't know really what it means, but I mean, it sort of is a measles type rash. Don't go just by that, because there's lots of other things that can cause a morbilliform rash, and most likely it's not going to be measles in our state. So this is just another picture of the cockle spots. See these tiny little white things? And it'd be so easy to miss. And yet, you know, you know like I do how hard it is to get a kid's mouth open. So you have to get a good light and have somebody hold the kid to look well. This is just another picture. This is actually from the CDC website. They have some pictures posted on there of different viral infections. And you can see this kid just looks really sick. You've got that really red sclera. Not a lot of pus, but real watery, and the rash is extensive on the face, and the kid looks sick. This is another little girl. Again, look at these eyes. They're all kind of leaky. She looks like she kind of got a little ptosis. I don't know what that's about. But again, sick looking with this conjunctivitis, and of course she would be coughing a lot and have a lot of nasal congestion. Okay, so differential diagnosis. Let's talk about the things you guys might really see. So remember, all the kids that we immunize with the MMR, and I was asking my residents this last week, and I said, okay, so how many of you guys talk to the patients about this rash that they can get after the vaccine? They're like, oh, I don't know, I don't know, it's on the sheet, whatever. So I guess probably one of the few important things that we do. Most parents know, okay, your kid might get fussy, they might get a sore leg, they might, you know, get a knot. But most of us, the most important thing is to say, hey, guess what? You're going to forget they got the shot, and 2 weeks from now or 10 days from now, they're going to get a rash. You're going to say, oh my gosh, what is this? And if you tell them to anticipate that, then maybe they'll remember it. So it's very common. 1 out of 20 kids that we give the MMR to are going to get this rash. Sometimes very mild, might not be very, you know, hardly noticeable, but some will be, and I've seen a couple of kids that are very extensive. And as a healthcare provider, we might have to ask or look up in the records if their patients of ours to say, oh yeah, you know what, they're about that age, they shouldn't have given the MMR. Maybe this is the post, you know, this is their reaction, which is a good thing, right? Their mini infection that's boosting their immunity so they don't get the real thing. They can have fever, they can have, is it, you know, when you read about it, it says usually they don't have the three C's, but there were two cases in our Twilight Clinic this past probably 3 months where the docs that were seeing the kids really thought it was measles. But when they sent off the PCR because the kids were sicker looking, and I guess maybe this doc forgot about that time sequencing too, it was the vaccine strain. So yeah, it was measles, but it was vaccine strain, which just means your body was just, you know, Yeah.
Are you seeing it more with the first vaccine or the second?
Yeah, the first more common one, yeah. And I think that, I don't know, it is more common with the first, yeah, with the first vaccine. So anyway, it's not contagious. You don't have to.
I'm glad you brought that not contagious up, because I had been taught and warned pregnant ladies that they should wait to get the vaccine until their GYN instructed them, you know, that they were far.
Well, the moms, we're not going to give the vaccine to when they're pregnant.
No, I mean the
kids.
Children.
Oh, yeah, it's fine. Yeah, so, I mean, you know, when you talked, and I did ask the ID doc about this, he said theoretically it is a live vaccine, you know, theoretically, but really, unless there's somebody truly immunocompromised, like on chemotherapy with an ANC of, you know, 15 or something, I mean, so we really do not postpone that vaccine for an otherwise healthy. I mean, you know, pregnancy does immune suppress you a little bit, but yeah, it's they're not contagious, and you don't really have to worry about it. And you can tell she doesn't look as sick, right? She's got the rash. She doesn't have the conjunctivitis. It's an impressive rash, but it's not measles. Okay, so what's another case? And so this is what I want you to pay more attention to, is the stuff that people might call measles. It is not, because that's what you're going to be seeing more of. So this patient was seen for a low-grade fever, otitis media. Go ahead, I don't know if you can turn the lights down. I don't know that I have that capability up here. Oh, wait, here. Light. Wait. Can you guys see it okay? I like my pictures look really good. this patient was given amoxicillin for his otitis media, and on day 4 he developed this rash, and the daycare thought it was measles and sent him directly to the doctor's office. He was not ill at all, but that rash looks what we would say is morbilliform, right? So it looks like the measles rash, but if you take the history, you realize the kid's on an antibiotic. He doesn't have fever, he didn't have cough, didn't have conjunctivitis. This is not measles. Plus, if he'd already been vaccinated, you know, 6 months before, 3 months before, he's not even susceptible to it. So this is a drug-related crash. And if we think about, you know, you hear that kids who have like mono, they give them amoxicillin, like 90% of them will get a rash, and so that's sort of one way to kind of diagnose mono. Well, this is the same kind of rash. It's not really a drug allergy per se. It's your body's reaction with the virus, the interaction of the virus with the antibiotic that causes this morbilliform rash. Now, and so it's not really a contraindication to get the antibiotic again, but most parents are going to say, no, I'm not doing that again. But it's not really. I mean, you could give it again because it's not a true drug reaction. It's just sort of a sort of side effect, sort of. And so this, and some people call it, the older docs call it sort of the amoxicillin rash, so you don't just have to have EBV, you could have some other virus, you get an otitis media that's associated with the virus, you give an antibiotic, and boom, you get a rash. That's why really we should try not to treat all otitis media, you know, the AAP recommendations on that. That really there are side effects of medications. Treatment is just to stop the drug during this rash, but antihistamines talk. But it is not measles. And if the kid has EBV, it's 80-90% of them get this rash. Okay, this is another case. 5-year-old presents with 5-day history of fever up to 103. So the fever started the first day. High fevers. Had some other kind of weird stuff. Puffy red hands and feet. Now that's a weird complaint to hear, isn't it? Red eyes, so the conjunctivitis, red cracked lips, and extreme irritability. And I've seen, I don't know how many cases of this, 30 or so, and they are the fussiest kids I've ever dealt with. This kid developed a maculopapular rash that started on her trunk. It seemed to be worse in the GU area. No cough, no paresis. So really, other than these symptoms, no other systemic stuff. But just the hand edema, redness, fussiness, fever. So here's this little girl, and this rash, it doesn't show up very well. Let me just walk around and see if I can turn the light off. Yeah, but she looks really sick.
There's something over here.
So she has a conjunctivitis. white lights. I should probably just. The whole room will go zip. So anyway, her lips look red. Her conjunctiva are injected. There's really no discharge from the eyes, though, right? And here's her rash. It's not morbid, but. Oh, you picked up on it, yeah. This is a different cure of the same disease. And I'm supposed to say, did you notice? Good job. All right, you are paying attention. can you turn the lights down a little bit? Thank you so much. I don't know where they are. So this rash is more intensified in the groin area, and it was a little bit, you know, less impressive. You know, it wasn't a true morbilliform, but with this disease, they can have a morbilliform type. They can have lots of different types of rashes. So this is Kawasaki syndrome. Has anybody ever seen it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's bad stuff. And so what you don't want to do is diagnose somebody with Kawasaki with measles and be wrong, because if they don't get treated with the right treatment, they're going to get a coronary aneurysm and have a heart attack 10 or 15 years later. So it's bad stuff, yeah. So you have to be able to recognize what is not measles. So it's an acute multi-system vasculitis. We don't really know what causes it. There's lots of theories. And the diagnosis is based on fever, usually high fever, for at least 5 days and at least 4 to 5. I'm not going to go through all that because you guys can do that yourself. But the rash can be, look at all the different things a rash can be. It can be scarlatiniform, it can be hives, it can be macular papilla, morbilliform, which is like our measles rash, or target lesions. It can be anything. But there's some weird stuff with it. Kids with measles don't get swollen red hands and feet. They don't have no cough or no runny nose. So it's just one of those things to kind of keep in your mind, a differential diagnosis. And if you think that a kid has this, you need to send them to UK probably to get treated. So there is some recent version of the American Heart Association that says it really, if a kid has 4 more criteria, you can diagnose it on day 4 of fever. I mean, it's really terrible to say, hey, this is Kawasaki. Let's wait 2 more days before we treat them. You know, I wouldn't want that to happen to my kid. So this officially says you can treat them better earlier. There is, you know, we think about Kawasaki's, you know, high platelet counts. That's later. So the stuff that you're going to look for acutely is going to be elevated serum CRP, sterile proteinuria, so white cells in the urine, if you look at the urine, and they can have elevation of their liver enzymes. Initially, their platelets are low. They can have anemia, hypoxia. So all this goes along with the vasculitis, basically. The high platelets, which can go into a million or more, is not until the second or third week. And we do a cardiac echo on those kids acutely, and then they're followed by cardiology after that to make sure that they don't develop an aneurysm. This is another picture of this cute little girl. Can you see how miserable she looks right there? She just looks like she just is awful. And here's after treatment. I mean, you just tell her face. This was the next day. So what do we treat with? IVIG. So that's not something we're going to, you know, treat unless we know it's Kawasaki. So you just need to keep it in mind. And then also high-dose aspirin so they don't clot with all those, with that possible aneurysm and also with the high platelets. If it's untreated, up to 1 out of 4, then we'll get a coronary aneurysm. And we had a medical student probably 10 years ago who was in medical school, and she had a massive MI and almost died. And in going back in her history, she had been diagnosed with Rocky Mountain spotted fever. But guess what? It was probably Kawasaki. And she didn't get the treatment. So anyway, that's on your differential diagnosis of a morbilliform rash. Okay, so that's it for measles and measles-like stuff. We're moving on to scarlet fever. This is something you guys are probably seeing a lot of. Something that we still see a lot of. And the one thing I like to tell people is that, you know, sometimes the parents think like, oh my gosh, it's scarlet fever, it's so terrible. It's no different than just regular old strep throat. It just happens to be the toxin that goes to the skin and they get the rash. So really it doesn't mean anything else other than that. I mean, they might have had a grandfather that died from scarlet fever and they're a little bit, I always like to mention to them, it's okay, this is just like strep throat, you know, no big deal. The age is very important too with a lot of these. So a lot of our kids, this is usually school age kids. Of course, you guys know the symptoms, fever, pharyngitis, tonsil exudates. Fatigue are not often there, but if they are, they can be a real clue. Where are you going to have lymph nodes with strep throat? Anterior. EBV is going to be posterior, so you're going to want to palpate for those large anterior lymph nodes. Headache and malaise. So we know a lot of kids come in and they come in for just a headache, stomach ache, fever, nothing else. They don't complain of a sore throat. If you don't look at their skin, especially in the groin or the axilla or the neck area, you're going to miss that they have scarlet fever. You're going to miss that they have, you know, that they need to be treated for strep throat. Okay. So we have this tongue thing with scarlet fever, and first it starts out as a white strawberry tongue, and then that sort of goes away, and then they have these prominent red papillae. Sometimes the red papillae stick up through the white, and that's where they get the name of the strawberry tongue. They do have peeling that is in the perineal area during the acute stage, and then peripheral peeling 2 to 3 weeks later. And this we can do just a rapid strep. Some people would say if a kid has scarlet fever, you don't need to do a strep test because you already know that's what it is because they've got a sore throat or the clinical symptoms and a rash. But there are other things that can cause a scarlatiniform rash, and you don't want to miss those. So toxic shock can get a scarlatiniform rash. Kawasaki should get a scarlatiniform rash. So I actually like to always validate that's what they have. Of course, treatment is still just regular old penicillin. And, you know, strep throat will get better on its own without antibiotics, but they're going to feel better faster with treatment. And there's, you know, is a risk. I've seen one kid in my whole career that acutely that I diagnosed with rheumatic fever from strep throat. So, and to treat that, so we do treat it when we see it. You have 9 days to treat them. So it's not like, you know, if they come in, it's the fourth day, they're sore throat, that you're going to be, oh my gosh. So that's kind of nice. So this is just a look at this again. So if you have scarlet fever, they're going to get fever initially with the rash right here. You know, sore throat's going to be a little bit first, and then boom, up. They're going to get high the first couple of days. And even without treatment, the fever's going to go down. And again, the rash with measles is really not the fourth day. So this is the rash for scarlet fever. You can't see much here, but there was a fine pinpoint erythematous rash, and you know, we say it's like sandpaper, so if you close your eyes, sometimes for a rash, if I need to know if it's raised or not, I'll close my eyes and feel it, so I'm not fooled by what I see. And then this is, you see how it's intensified in the groin. So you need to look down there, and I'm really a big advocate of putting kids in gowns, because you're going to miss them otherwise. This is just the throat of a kid. This is the white strawberry tongue. There's starting to be a little bit of the red there. The papillae are pointing through. And these tonsils are beefy red and swollen. This is a little girl. In African American kids, it's a little bit harder to diagnose strep because they don't have the white skin, so you can't really see that the bumps are red. So sometimes I'll ask the parent. It looks kind of like keratosis pilaris to me, really, which is a really common thing we see. Usually it's not all over the body. Usually it's more just up here. But I'll say to the mom, is this new or is her skin always like and here's this red strawberry tongue here. This is a little girl who had scarlet fever, and she was sicker looking. She had a high fever at that time, and just really felt lousy. Her rash was pretty extensive, more extensive than what we usually see in scarlet fever. It's the small, fine papules and not those bigger, you know, red, larger lesions of measles. And then she had, a lot of times they describe perioral pallor with scarlet fever. And then her eyes, no conjunctivitis. She had sick eyes. And then there's something called posteoline. So they're kind of like petechiae that come up with strep throat and you can, or scarlet fever. And you can see it in the antecubital fossa or sometimes down here in the folds. Okay, so third disease is rubella. Germ and measles, really not nearly as big a deal for people who get it. Mainly it's a problem with the babies, right? So you're not really all that sick with rubella, which is a good thing, but if you're pregnant and you get it, then it can be devastating with the fetus. So the vaccine began in 1969, and really why did we start vaccinating to begin with was to prevent miscarriage, stillbirth, congenital rubella syndrome. Outbreaks still do occur because there are a lot of adults who've never had a rubella. And I know in the nursery, they will check the mom's titer during pregnancy, and if they're not immune, then we will give an MMR on their way out of the hospital. And I think hopefully a lot of places have done that, but they were saying that still there's it's not a routine vaccine or one of the organizations in Hispanic cultures, Mexico, and so we do have a lot of adults coming in with it. Incubation can be a little bit longer than measles. Up to 50% of the cases are asymptomatic, so they don't even know they have it, so that's kind of bad for the pregnant moms. You can get prodrome more commonly in the older age kids and adults. The rash is rose pink macules and papules. That same way that it spreads as measles, but it doesn't last as long, it's not nearly as obvious. And complications mainly with older people, but we don't deal well with these viral infections, arthralgias, arthritis, and generalized adenopathy. So here's a little kiddo with rubella. If you wanted to test to see if that's what it is or not, you can get antibody testing and see if the titers go up. You're contagious for 7 days after you get the rash. So if we look at rubella, if you look at measles, here is day one of the rash, not day one of the illness, because you're going to have fever and all the C's earlier than that. So it starts at the head. The rash is discreetly in public spots. Then you have rubella. The first day of the rash, you get a lot more. So really the rash doesn't progress as much. Day three of measles, you've got a bad rash. Rubella, it's kind of like already almost faded, and then you just have it left on the and then scarlet fever the rash starts with the fever and you have it more in the antecubital fossa, and it's more pinpoint, and those are the things I already described there. So let's look at scarlet fever again. You get the rash, sore throat, and rubella. You get, look at fever. The lowest one of all of these. So they should just not get sick, really. You can have some lymphadenopathy that starts. You can have some lace. Again, these are mainly older kids. And you can have even a little bit of conjunctivitis and a little bit of a stuffy nose, but not much and not all the kids. Okay, parvo, fist disease. That's probably the one we use that number the most, I think. And we still see a lot of parvo virus. You guys have kids, your kids have probably had it. Pretty well known entity, and it's kind of a fun diagnosis. So human parvovirus B19. So in the U.S., 60% of adults are seropositive. So those of us who are adults, most of us have already had it. So it's pretty prevalent. It's going to be school age kids, even older than strep throats, from 4 to 10. Now the interesting thing about parvovirus is that you have the viremia first. Most of the time you don't have any symptoms, or if you do, they're very, very mild. Then the rash comes afterwards. And so that's kind of an interesting progression. And what we kind of love about it is it's easy to recognize. It starts with the slack cheeks, and then nobody's really quite sure about that. And then a lot of times they don't come to the doctor for this part. They're like, they got a sunburn, or who knows, they look a little flushed. But then it's not until the later part when the exanthem spreads to involve the trunk and extremities. So they get this slack cheek and then it's the trunk. And it can coalesce and be sort of confluent. That goes pretty quickly and then turns into that lacy rash that can last for weeks and weeks. And sometimes a parent will come in and say, my kid is still getting this rash. When they come out from running or they come out of the shower, it looks terrible. It'll be mainly left on the extremities, that kind of lacy rash. So really, it's a clinical diagnosis. You can ask about, do they have red cheeks, and you can sort of try to jog mom's memory about that. And it's really no big deal. We don't care about it unless somebody's pregnant. And if somebody's pregnant, they've been around the pregnant person, they already exposed them before they had the rash. So if I see the kids and they're in school, and they say, well, my teacher's pregnant, I'll say, well, I can send you back to school today because you're not contagious, but you need to tell your teacher that she needs to go to the OB. because if the mom was not immune, so if she was the 40% that hadn't had it, she gets it during the pregnancy, especially first trimester, it can result in high drops, fatalis, and fatality, and a miscarriage of the baby. Older people can get arthritis, and parvovirus in older people is not a good thing. Really, they can, just like anything else, we just don't know as well. So this slide summarizes it. So you get this, you know, you get contact, prodrome, a lot of people don't even have a prodrome, or might be mild cold symptoms, flushed cheeks, 1 to 2 days later, they get the rash, and then that fades, and then they get sort of this, what's left on this. So this is a little guy I saw, who has still flat cheeks here. And then he has the more confluent. This is going to get lacy, but this was kind of like in the second stage of it. It was interesting. There's something also with parvovirus that's called stocking glove syndrome, where they get these actually purpuric hands and feet. It's also due to parvovirus. So this little guy, his feet were really red. So it was kind of like on that spectrum, I guess, of that. But that's real. This is a little bit atypical because it seems to be a little more confluent, but that does happen, and then it's going to fade. Here's another little guy who, again, this is kind of confluent here, but it's more faded here on this part. Okay, so we're up to 6 disease. Human herpes 6 usually affects young children, so you're not going to have somebody, if the resident comes out and tells me the 6-year-old has roseola, I'm going to laugh at them because we just don't need it at that age. So again, you need to know what the age group is that different viral infections usually affect them to help with the diagnosis. So the peak is 6 to 7 months. And the bummer about that is you get high fever with nothing else. And so what do? We worry that we're missing a serious SBI, serious bacterial infection. And that makes us worry because, unfortunately, the rash doesn't come until the fever's gone. So once they get the rash, it's like, oh, yeah, I know what that was roseola. But when you're seeing them at day 1 or 2, and they've got a temp of 104, and they're fussy, and sometimes they have a full fontanelle, then those babies, you're going to end up having to do more with them. The rash is very kind of, this rash comes and goes really more quickly than any of the other viral exanthems. It can be gone in 24 hours. But it certainly is there, and it can come a day or two after the fever goes away. So it can, what else could be associated with it? They don't have any other symptoms. I mean, swollen lymph nodes. They actually can have, one thing is they can have puffy eyes. So I have seen some kids where they'll be like, you know, I don't know, 9 months old, and they'll have, this will be their second day of temp of 103, and they look kind of fussy, but not toxic. And I'll think, this is probably roseola. And if their eyes are puffy, that makes me think, oh yeah, for some reason, roseola seems to cause puffy eyes along with it. And there's really even, there's a PCR for roseola now, and so in my clinic, I still see this, but I still worry about the kids, and I still at least do a cath urine, because that's gonna be the most, you know, the most common cause of a serious bacterial infection that you don't want to miss. In boys less than a year, especially uncircumcised, and girls less than 2. So it used to be, before we had pneumococcal and H flu vaccine, we would do blood cultures on these kids. We would start them on antibiotics. And we'd do a white count. If the white count was elevated, we'd start antibiotics for possible bacteremia. We don't really do that much anymore because we don't have as much bacteremia or meningitis as what we used to. But I will do at least a cath urine. I hate to do it because I'm thinking in my head, this is probably roseola, they're probably going to get a rash in 2 days. But if it's not and they've got Tylo, then I'm already causing kidney damage, so we just can't take that risk. So prognosis is excellent if they, you know, if they make it through without being traumatized by us and our procedures. So this is my sweet little daughter. She's 16 now, but she would hate to be dead. You know, I show this picture all the time for the med students, and she doesn't know I'm doing it. She would kill me. But this was when she was a toddler. I think she was about 15 or 16 months in. And this is a cat scratch. This is something kind of like it. And she had these puffy eyelids, actually. And she ran high temps, and like probably the day 2 or day 3, because it was before pneumococcal H vaccine, I took her to the clinic. I said, okay, guys, I don't know. You decide whether you're going to tap her or not. But she definitely needs blood cultures, and she definitely needs a cath urine. And so I kind of lived through it. And then her fever went away, and then as then her rash came on within, you know, 12 hours. And so they're, it's kind of different. Again, it's not morbilliform. They're not as prominent. They're a little bit larger in size, and mainly on the trunk. Starts on the trunk and then spreads to the other parts. So roseola is the one that is the scariest to me. I think, oh, roseola's not an example. Yeah, here we go. So here's the high fever, okay? There's no rash. There's irritability, that's it, which makes us worry about what the heck is going on. Then boomo, and there's the rash. So that's kind of how that goes. Okay, we're down to our cases. I think we have four cases. Clickers are anonymous. I don't like high pressure anything. I don't like to teach by pressure. I don't pimp anybody. But this just makes it kind of funny. So time to solve the cases. And here's some more pictures. School age child, Sarah, sunburned like rash on her cheeks. Now she has a rash on her extremities. On trunk some, but mainly on the extremities. She has no other symptoms but fever. Rash on the face is erythematous. Mom says the rash on the trunk and the extremity started confluent and they faded and they're lacy and reticular. Now let's see if this is gonna work. Yeah. Oh, the pulling. Let's see, somebody push a button and see what happens. It may or may not work. I don't know if I, is it working? Are you guys pushing buttons? Oh, it's not working. Somehow it didn't get hooked up right. There might be a way to do it, but I'm not gonna worry about it. Okay, what do you guys think it is?
B.
All right, parvovirus, 100%. Good job. All right, so this disease, parvovirus. Oh,
look. Oh, it did.
It did.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
I had to push the button. Okay, that was my fault. Okay. All right, toddler with a high fever, no symptoms. 2-year-old went to the hospital for a high fever for 3 days. This is an old picture. How do we know there is a styrofoam cup? You see, she's covering the IV on her hand. It stains my picture. But look at this rash. I might even say it sort of kind of looks like more morbilliform a little bit. But not a lot on the face, mainly on the trunk. She didn't have any other stuff, cough, conjunctivitis, just high fever. She did have a full fontanel. So then she got attacked. You can't see she has a band-aid on her back because she got an LP. But the LP looked normal. She was starting antibiotics for, you know, possible, you know, bacteria. Then the next day, boom, she breaks out the rash. And she is just feeling great now. Okay. Let me know when you guys are done. I just have two more cases. I'm going to finish on time. One, two. You guys might still be doing it. Wait, oh, yeah. All right, yay! Well, we're so smart. Roseola.
Yes.
Okay, good deal. This, look at this little 15-month-old. I think he's a slobber. So, 15-month-old who's being seen for a rash was referred by a doctor, this is a Citra case, who had worked overseas and seen a lot of me. He says this is the real thing. She had a 2-day history of fever. 101 was the Tmax, so really not that high. 1-day history, so she had a fever for 2 days, and then then about a day into the fever, had a rash. It started on her face and neck and spread down. She has a mild runny nose, and I don't know if that's spit or runny nose. I think it's spit in her down belly. So what does Jane have? All right, okay. It is none of the above. So if we asked, so think about it, go back and look at her. She had Tim of 101, nothing higher. She's 15 months. She just got her vaccines a week before. I didn't tell you that information. You know why? Because the mom's not going to tell it to you either. So you're going to have to think, oh, huh, yeah, she was just here for a well visit. So that was the none of the above because it was the post-vaccine measles. And so we didn't need to do anything, say, oh yeah, this is good. It means that she is building immunity to that measles infection. Okay, last, and this is the kid that was seen in Twilight. So they were worried about him. He'd gotten his vaccine about 10 days before, but pretty impressive post-vaccine rash. He had a little bit of a runny nose. He had a little bit of low-grade fever. And actually, one of the residents said she thought she even saw complex spots. And you can see all of that, again, but it's the vaccine strain. So it's the attenuated live vaccine. So they're not going to get as sick. And that's, you know, so that's what this little guy had when they sent off his PCR Tuesday. Okay, last case. One 15-month-old who's on day 6 of fever, ranging from 103 to 105. So that's a lot of days of fever. Red swollen hands and feet. It's hard to tell. A lot of times, again, with toddlers, you have to ask the parents, are those hands and feet swollen, or are they always that fat? Because the mom will know. Injected eyes, you can't really see very well. He was not happy, so incredibly irritability. With no discharge of his eyes. Look at these lips, just red, and almost sort of starting to have some excoriations there. And some peeling lips, too. And a rash. Again, next time I do this, I'm going to have to make sure I know how to turn off the lights. But this is not a morbilliform, but certainly it's a maculopapular rash that's erythematous. And on his trunk, it was increased in his diaper area. He had no cough, no coryza, no complex spots. He did have conjunctivitis, though. What does he have? And we'll end the day.
Can you describe injected eyes? What do you mean by?
So you know the white part of the eyes, the blood vessels, just really, really prominent. And so we would call it pink eye, I guess. But sometimes, you know, pink eyes, not that descriptive. But just injected, the white part was very, very red.
Okay.
And then if you pull down here, the conjunctiva down there would be kind of red too. But no.
Bloodshot? Is it the same?
Yeah, bloodshot, same thing.
Okay.
Same thing, except for sort of like intense bloodshot.
Okay.
So yeah.